It's a great pleasure to be here, visit IQC. I'll tell you about work that's going on in my group that revolves around Diamond, and particularly how we are using tools from nanoscale optics, nanophotonics, to engineer quantum properties of color centers in Diamond. And these kind of colorful colors that you see in the back are Diamond microcrystals that can emit very many different colors. So by the end of this talk, I'd like to tell you why we care about it, what's quantum about them, and how we can use optics to make them even more brilliant in some sense. So in general, in my group, we study photons. So this is, we are a photonic device group. And photons by themselves are interesting, but even more interesting when you couple them to other things. Okay, so we like to look in interaction of photons, atoms, molecules, electrons. Atoms really are virtual, these virtual atoms that I'll tell you about today. We don't do any atom trapping. But what we are interested in is how we can use these interactions for different disciplines, or different fields of research, and also how we can engineer these interactions using the tools of nanoscale optics in general. And if you do that, then basically you can study many, very many different things that range from kind of silicon photonics, some biosensing, optomechanics. Recently, we started publishing in this field that's been going on for a few years, mid-infrared photonics, this work on chemical sensors based on surface, based on essentially controlling wettability of 3D photonic crystals is something that was actually, it's being spearheaded by a student of mine, Ian Burgess, who is Waterloo graduate and also was done by two co-ops. So, but I won't tell you anything about this. I'll just focus on this part of research. But hopefully this is motivation to invite me again, and then I'll tell you about other stuff too. So Diamond nanophotonics. But before, first let's maybe say a few words about Diamond and why we are interested in Diamond. Well, it's material with exceptional properties. Here I list a few. It's transparent over a very wide range of spectrum, and being an optics group, this is very interesting to us. Plus, it has very large refractive index. You know, 2.4 refractive index is not quite up there as a silicon, but it's much better than some glasses like silicon dioxide and whatnot, so it gives you enough freedom in designing optical structures in Diamond. It's compatible, biomedically compatible, inert, so this is important for some of the applications in sensing that we are investigating. Excellent mechanical properties, thermal properties, and so on and so forth. In spite of all of these things, still recently, main application of industrial application and technological, in some sense, of Diamond was for grinding, cutting, polishing, and things like that, exploiting basically mechanical properties. It was largely due to the fact that we didn't have these nice, clean substrates of Diamond at our disposal so that we can start dreaming about some engineering, doing some engineering inside Diamond to take advantage of these properties. Recently, that has changed significantly, largely due to the work done in Element 6, which is a company in UK, spin-off from De Beers Diamond, I guess. And they are growing these beautiful, clean, single crystal Diamond substrates in all shapes and sizes. And now, being an engineer myself, it's nice because I can make reproducibly devices over and over again and study some system level integration in Diamonds. So it's quite nice. With that, and there's a bunch of other companies who are doing these things, but this is the one that we collaborate strongly with. In addition to this, due to this, I should really say, people started exploring all of this, taking advantage of all these nice properties of Diamonds to look into different applications. They are listed here, but today, for my talk, I like to focus on application quantum information science technology that really takes advantage of this large number of color centers in Diamond that can act as qubits, single photon sources, and also very nice spin memory. So I'll tell you more about that, basically, how, what we're doing with Diamond in this space. Here, this picture, these are a bunch of gemstones. The color of these gemstones is controlled by the impurities that you have in the system. If you add nitrogen, the Diamond looks yellow. If you put boron, it looks blue, and so on and so forth. It turns out that many of these centers, and these are actually impurities in Diamond, but many of them actually emit light. If you excite them, let's say in green, they emit red. Okay, and that's what color center is, essentially. It's an impurity in a Diamond lattice that can emit photons. And there are many, many, really, these color centers that were also well understood due to the interest from gem industry. And here I list only a few. Nitrogen vacancy, silicon vacancy, Here's basically a nickel complex called chromium center. What they are, as I mentioned, that basically in the case of nitrogen vacancy center, it's simply impurity in diamond lattice where you take one carbon atom and replace it with nitrogen, and then you take nearby carbon atom out and don't replace it with anything, so you have vacancy there. So now this nitrogen vacancy thing, when it traps one electron, when excited in green light, emits red. Okay, and this is the one that we'll work on here. In particular, because though many of these have nice properties as single photon sources, but this nitrogen vacancy color center has very nice electron spin properties that can be used as a memory. In particular, spin coherence time of this color center are very long, which means information can be stored inside the spin of NV, in the electron spin of NV, as well as nuclear spin, and then can be retrieved. And it can be done all optically. This is actually a very nice thing. It's kind of, to some sense, I would say unique to diamond, but there's other centers in silicon carbide, for example, that can do these things, as recently demonstrated by a group at UCSB. But indeed, this is nice property that you have memory in electron spin that can be addressed optically. The level, this is the level diagram of this color center, and this is simplified. But in my talk, I'm going to simplify it even further. We are not going to worry about at all electron spin properties in the center. I'm mostly focused on optical properties. So what we'll be doing, we'll be exciting center in green and watch red luminescence, and we'll see how nanostructuring or building devices around color centers improve these properties. And this just gives you the spectrum of color center, of nitrogen vacancy color center in room temperature and low temperature, non-Kelvin. What you see at room temperature, there's this zero phonon line, which is emission from this state to that state without participation of any phonons, which is remarkable. You can see it at room temperature even. But when you cool it down, you see this line, zero phonon line, it becomes much sharper. So a lot of luminescence, about 5% of luminescence, does go into zero phonon line. It's not perfect, but people are willing to put up with this phonon sideband due to this nice spin property of diamond. This color center that I mentioned here actually can be found in these pink diamonds. And here is one pink diamond we had in the lab, and this is a synthetic diamond. If it was a real diamond, it would be very, very expensive, but this was a synthetic diamond. And it turns out that this pink color in part comes from, and this was grown by Apollo Diamond Company, in part comes from a lot of nitrogen vacancy centers that you have in it. Really, if you take green laser point and shoot the light at this gem, it glows red. So it's quite nice. Unfortunately, our samples look more like this. So they're kind of boring cubes of diamond that are transparent, looks much like glass, because if we want them to be clean, and then we put some metals as a mask and whatnot, that's where the color comes from. But basically, the piece of diamond is 2 by 2 millimeter in dimensions and half a millimeter thick. And that's sort of, you know, it can get a little bigger, a little smaller, but that's about it, which, you know, if you're a silicon guy or 3-5 person, then your wafers are much, much bigger. So already just the size of this wafer actually causes a lot of problem in fabrication, and we need to figure out ways how to make devices in diamond. It's technological constraints, so I'll address that also. So, okay, so why, so these are some of the applications that you can do if you want to take advantage of this nice electron spin and optical properties of color center. And they range from quantum cryptography, quantum information processing, and nanoscale magnetic field sensing. Some of this work is also done in David Corey's lab here in IQC. But what's common to all of these applications is that the signal-to-noise ratio in these applications is directly proportional to how many photons you have at your disposal. Okay? So the more photons you can get from color center, into your collection optics, the better signal-to-noise ratio in each of these applications. Okay? But the problem with diamond is that the refractive index of diamond is large. It can be nice and also can be a bad thing. So a lot of light that gets emitted by a color center actually never leaves diamond substrate. Okay? So this is 3D finite difference time modeling that we've done where we model a dipole, which is representative of a color center, inside diamond substrate, just below the surface, and we see how much light goes out. Well, not much light goes out due to total internal reflection at this diamond air interface due to the large refractive index. Okay, so it's very, very, very simple and common problem even in solid state lighting using gallium nitride and some other materials. If you calculate, you get roughly 3% of light from NV center leaves diamond substrate and can be collected. Okay, this is another problem. Light that does leave the diamond also gets kind of emitted in all kinds of different directions. Here is emission profile for two different polarization, S and P, and this shows far field emission. So above this half plane is basically emission above substrate, below is emission into substrate. You see that most of the light goes into substrate, really, and very little goes up, okay? And goes also into the cone, collection cone, it's quite wide. So we need to improve that. This is where my interest started, basically talking to physicists, and they saw this as a problem. So we wanted to improve this situation and give them more photons. And then we also got excited about it, so we're doing a lot of quantum stuff ourselves now as well. So, but before I tell you what I've been doing in my lab, or rather my students have been doing in my lab, here is what others are doing. And we tried some of these too, and these different approaches have pros and cons. And this is a somewhat older slide. There's a lot has been done since 2009 in many of these approaches, so I'd be happy to share some additional references if you're interested. But bottom line is, what can you do? You can grow diamond, large quantities of diamond on other substrate like silicon, but then this diamond turned out to be polycrystalline, and then it's not very useful for applications in quantum optics. So that's out. You can use smart cutting or ion slicing, which is very similar to what people do in silicon to realize silicon insulator wafers, where you essentially launch ions into the diamond, graphitize part of the diamond, and then etch away this diamond damaged layer, this graphite, and then you have this freestanding substrate. Well, that's also not very good because at least this initial demonstration showed that there's a lot of strain that you put in this top substrate, which actually compromises the properties of color centers. So we didn't quite want to pursue this either. You can use diamond as a substrate and put some other material on top of it and make structures in it. But the problem there is finding materials that is transparent enough in red and has high refractive index contrast than diamond. That's not trivial. So gallium phosphide is one such material. There was beautiful work done at HP Labs along these lines, but they found quite a few problems bonding these 3-5 materials in diamond, partly because of the size of diamond substrate is small. The surfaces are not as smooth as it may be in 3-5 or silicon materials. So there's still ongoing research, but you know, we wanted kind of to see what else that can be done. You can also work with nanocrystals, diamond nanocrystals, range from 5 nanometers to micron size. And then it's easy. You just take these diamond nanocrystals, put it on anything you want. In this case, it's plasmonic structure, or you can put it in an optical cavity. Okay, so now a cavity is made of anything, silicon nitride, and this is a microsphere cavity made in glass, and you put your nanocrystal here. That's nice, but it's not very scalable. Okay, so I'd like to build systems. I'm engineer by training. So I'd like to build many systems, and also color centers in these nanocrystals are not really as good as color centers in, for some of the application, as color centers in bulk substrate. When we started looking into this, my main sort of boundary condition was that whatever we do, it should be done in bulk diamond. That's it. So here, these are 3D geometries that I'd like to tell you about today that resulted from this research, essentially, of trying to make devices in diamond. I'll tell you about challenges and also where we are at the moment. So first geometry I'll tell you about is diamond nanowires. Then I'll tell you about some of the work with plasmonics that we've done. And finally, some of the work with diamond optical resonators that we are quite excited about. And all of these they're kind of complementary depending on what you want to do. Some of these approaches may be more suitable than some others. All right, so diamond nanowires. So the idea is very simple. So since we have this total internal reflection problem, we need to kind of get rid of it somehow. So the simplest thing that you consider is that if you put these color centers indicated by these light bright spots inside some sort of optical waveguide, emission from them is going to be preferentially coupled into the waveguide of the structure. And this can be calculated fairly simply using very simple dipole emission profile and taking advantage of total internal reflection and whatnot. The simplest waveguide you can make is actually by etching these pillars inside diamond vertically. And so what we've done, we took the diamond substrates with randomly distributed color centers, and we made a bunch of these nanowires, or we wanted to do that. And we wanted to see how much light actually does, how much improvement in collection efficiency we get in the system. And when you do your finite difference time domain modeling, designing this experiment, you compare NV center in bulk and NV center this nanowire, and you find out that it goes like follows. Roughly 80% of light from NV couples to the waveguide mode. The waveguide is properly designed. 50% of that goes up, 50 goes down. So for the first experiment, we didn't worry about this 50% that goes down. We just said bye-bye to it. And then whatever goes up, which is 40% of total emission, kind of sees a little bit 10% reflection, 90% goes through. So you calculate very quickly back on the envelope that roughly 36% of light actually goes up. Then you do finite difference time domain modeling, and you calculate this profile exactly. And this is what I'm showing you, that in a nanowire is in red, far field emission, above substrate, below substrate, and blue is bulk. And you notice, first of all, you see a lot more light up, okay, roughly 10 times more. And also what's nice, you have this antenna effect that whatever couples into the nanowire waveguide goes straight into your objective lens. Okay, because it's nicely, not collimated, but nicely directed towards your lens because of this waveguide far field emission profile. When you do calculation and you compare the numbers, you find out that FDTD gives you result that's very close to this back on the envelope. And with nanowire, you get 30% collection efficiency. With bulk, only 3. And that tenfold increase in collection efficiency was quite substantial and important that we decided to make these things. Okay, so next thing that we had to worry about, how do we make it? Diamond is the hardest material on Earth. It seems less intimidating. And that's why I gave this project to one of the interns in my group first. And I figured, you know, if she succeeds, she's going to be famous. Her name is Birgit. She published a few papers, so she did succeed. If she doesn't, okay, you know, just intern. What can we do? She wasn't from Waterloo. She was from Max Planck, you know, another very good place. So she spent a year in my group, and she figured out how to make them. Okay, and they look very nice. Ron Walsford likes to call them stormtroopers. And they look a little bit like stormtroopers from distance, I guess. So what these things are, it takes your single crystal diamond substrate, and you use conventional fabrication technologies that we have at Harvard, and I'm excited to see you have very impressive facilities here, and to become more impressive. And conventional really means electron beam lithography. Oh, we didn't grow these, by the way. I don't know how to grow anything, so we only know how to destroy material, so that's what we've done. So we take electron beam lithography, make a mask, and then use oxygen plasma. It turned out to be very simple. This was not the first device we made. There was a lot of devices that didn't look this pretty. But oxygen plasma with a little bit of argon, a little bit of chlorine, eats diamond quite nicely because it turns diamond into carbon dioxide. It's kind of sad, actually, that that happens. But that's what it is. It's good for us. And we get these nice wires, about 2 microns in height, 200 nanometers in diameter. And this is what we wanted based on our designs. You do confocal imaging. But by the way, I should mention, this is not the first generation, as I said. This is second or whatever, 10th generation, in which this particular picture, we actually implanted color centers. Okay, so this is nice. Another nice thing about nitrogen vacancy color centers is that you can take your pure diamond, carbon only, or mainly carbon, and then you implant nitrogen where you want, ideally. And these nitrogen, if this procedure is well controlled, potentially will cause nitrogen vacancy color centers because there's always going to be some defects with implantation. And potentially I could get each of these wires to have only one NV inside, right? The yield in this particular experiment wasn't that great, maybe 10, 20%. Since then we found out how to improve it. But I'll talk a little more about this in a few minutes. So in this case, we did implantation, actually. And so what we have now, this is confocal image. We take green laser pointer and scan it over the array and collect red light. And you see that sometimes, you know, some of the nanowire becomes very bright, which means we have NV, at least one inside. Sometimes they're dark, which means there's no NV in it. And sometimes they're somewhat bright, which probably means NV was not quite on the axis, but a little bit off axis, and not quite in the middle of nanowire. So what we want to confirm is we have individual color centers. So we want to make single photon source, which is what's needed for these guys to act as a nodes of quantum network. They would be, like each of these would be one quantum memory, one quantum register, I should say. So to confirm this, first we wanted to make sure this emission does come from NV. So if you take a look at the spectrum, you see this nice NV color center spectrum, zero photon line, And this modulation, we believe, comes from this kind of small Fabry-Pérot resonance that's formed by the nanowire. Then you do your standard Henry-Brown twist experiment where you look for anti-bunching. The idea is if you have single photons coming on a beam splitter, photon is either going to be here or there. So if you look how frequently photon is here and there, this probability should be zero. And that's how you can confirm you have single photons. So you do this measurement, cross-correlation measurement, you find these curves that are basically raw data, and they dip well below 0.5 coincidence counts, normalized coincidence counts, which is indicative of single photon emission. As a matter of fact, they go all the way down to 0.006, which also indicates we have a very well controlled process. There's not much background emission in this case. And so this was very nice, but you know, still we need to confirm that indeed we benefit from nanowire geometry in terms of collection efficiency. So we then tested a bunch of nanowire, I should really say Tom Babinek, my student, tested a lot of these nanowires and developed all of this characterization for this experiment. And then he tested six nanowire NVs in bulk diamond and roughly six in NVs in nanowire. And you indeed find that photon counts per second in the case of nanowire, which is shown on y-axis, as a function of green pump power on x-axis, indeed 10 times larger than what you see in bulk. And that's exactly what we predicted. And what also counts for free is the fact that you need to pump 10 times less to get 10 times more, right? And the reason is because for green light, these nanowires act as waveguides as well. So they trap green light and improve coupling between green light and NV, so pumping is more efficient. So it's quite nice now because if I want to do this interrogation and resonance for some quantum information processing applications, I need to send down 10 times less red to get 10 times more red on resonance transmission. I'm not going to elaborate this. If you're working in this field, this may be interesting. If not, forget about the last few sentences. Okay, so it's quite nice. Two orders of magnitude improvement for certain experiments. We would like to operate at this point here, right, or above. This is kind of nice. We get 200,000, 300,000 photons. We could have even more. Our optical setup at that moment wasn't the most optimized. But really, in order to get million or tens of millions of photons, which would be very nice and liberating to start looking into some quantum properties like quantum jump, single shot readout of electron spin and whatnot, we need to work a little harder. And in addition to improving collection efficiency, we need to make more photons per second. So we need to basically do something more with the nanowires. But before I tell you what that more is, it's basically putting the structure in some sort of optical resonator. I'll tell you a little bit about two applications that kind of emerged from this. And one is some work we are doing with Michel Lukin. Basically, in physics at Harvard, the idea is now, okay, I have a bunch of these guys. I would like to connect two of them, but these emit photons vertically, right? So this is not quite integrated network on chip. But that's fine. What I can do, I can use these MEMS mirrors, for example, and pick any two nanowires and connect them. And if they have NVs inside, I can, you know, then start doing some, send them on a beam splitter and try to entangle basically NVs. So this is kind of one direction that we are going to, that's kind of ongoing work in progress. And this is something that we borrowed from ion trapping community, this idea. Another experiment that maybe you've seen already, I think Amir Jacobi was here recently. This is work that we've done with Amir, in particular with his postdoc, Patrick Malatinsky, where what they did, they liked this nanowire geometry quite a bit, so we showed them how to make it, and then they carve out one of the nanowires, and they have this nice diamond bar with diamond nanowire in the end, and they glue it to some sort of AFM, in this case, I think, pulled optical fiber. And what's nice, if you have a little NV center at the tip of this nanowire, you can start actually approaching it to substrates of interest that have some magnetic activity and take advantage of electron spin and the fact that the amount of red light that comes out of NV is dependent on the spin that of the NV, you can actually get magnetic image of your substrate. So that's exactly what they did. And this is very nice work that you can find in the archive and read more about it. So these are two applications. Some other that we are looking into is in kind of chemical sensing, bio, you can start poking things, and mechanical also, right? These nanowires and mechanical modes, which could be also quite interesting. But how do we get 10 million counts? So, well, we would like to control the emission rate of color centers inside diamond. And there is a few things how we can do that, approaches to do that. First, we studied what happens if you make these nanowires a little smaller or a little bigger. And it turned out if they make them a little smaller, and this is 200 nanometers tall instead of 2 microns, they're roughly 200 nanometers wide, which is roughly the same as this one. We found out that we can actually quench the emission from NVs, and I'll tell you a little more about that. But also now, if I take this substrate and slap some silver on it, and this is a cartoon of the structure, basically I take pillars of diamond and put silver on part of the substrate and don't cover the rest with silver, I make these very small optical cavities, plasmonic cavities, that consist of diamond. So diamond is at the bottom, and this pillar is made of diamond, and they're covered with silver. And that, this structure, this aperture, can confine light in very small mode volume, okay? And therefore, in the optical fields can be very, very large, which means coupling from NV now to the optical field can be significantly boosted. And that coupling, due to essentially Fermi's golden rule, Purcell enhancement, depends how you want to look at it, gives you enhancement of radiative emission that can be as large as 30, okay? Which means if, so this shows, this is theory that shows how faster photons get emitted in this geometry versus NV in bulk as a function of wavelength for different radii of these pillars, okay? And it turns out, so basically this would give you 35 times more photons per second than in NV if I can realize this experimentally, plus 10 times enhancement in collection. It's like 350 times more than the bulk, which is quite nice. Okay, so that was good. So then we decided to make it using exactly this approach, make these pillars and then slap some silver on it, and then we tested them. So this is the first that shows the spectrum from one of these pockets, diamond pockets or diamond nano apertures, or plasmonic nano cavities in diamond. This is the most buzz one, I guess, so let's stick with that one. So here what I'm showing is experimental result on y-axis is intensity. This is taken from spectrometer, not Purcell, but x-axis is the same. So in this purple color is ensemble measurement from a bunch of NVs in diamond. And then in the other colors are actually is emission from different nano cavities. And you see nice Lorentzian shape with quality factor in the order of 10, so which is exactly what you want at room temperature. You want to enhance broadband emission, okay? So plasmonics is quite nice for this application. So this was very nice match with theory, but you know, in order to really confirm, first of all, that these are now individual photons, that maybe it's just not luminescence from silver, because that can also happen, we needed to do a little more, and that little more is really to look into the statistics of this photon emission. So since we had a lot of silver on top, what we decided actually to probe this structure by illumination from the bottom through the diamond, which we can do because this was, again, implanted diamond substrate, so there was no NVs throughout the bulk, only at the top surface. And then what you do is just pay attention to these two curves. You find out that you still have anti-bunching. So these are pillars without metal on them, and these are pillars with metal on them. So both still dip below 0.5, so there's still evidence of anti-bunching. So this means there's one NV per one pillar. And this line width here was much narrower than here, which seems to indicate that lifetime was reduced. Okay, but in order to really quantify that, we built a time-resolved capability in our lab. And this was, again, work that was Tom Babinek in my group developed. Basically, he takes pulse lasers and then excites these centers and monitors decay, how they decay in time, how emission decays in time. And so here is comparison of three devices. This line is NV in bulk without doing anything to it. But these are shallow implanted color centers, like 20 to 90 nanometers. So lifetime is in the order of 60 nanoseconds. Then if you make pillar but don't put silver on it, you get this emission. So actually, the lifetime lengthens. So you quench emission. So it takes longer to emit photon, which is quite nice, and it can be actually quite useful for some applications. Okay, but if you put silver on it, then you go from this point to that point, so it emits now photons much, much faster due to this predicted plasmonic enhancement that I mentioned. And this just shows you this is, this is the capped one, and this says non-capped one. Maybe there's going to be questions later, so I posted this here. This shows that actually this quenching observation that you get less photons per second if you make the nanopillar is actually consistent with theory as well. And this is modeling that shows what is the lifetime of NV in post, depending when you put NV, compared to lifetime in bulk, T naught. And indeed, we see that lifetime of NV in post can be factor 5 to 6, even larger than in bulk. Okay, so it means 5 to 6 reduction in spontaneous emission rate, which is sort of consistent with what we see. If there is interest later, I can elaborate more on that. But really, the main point again was to see kind of what is the how far we can go. So here is comparison of all the devices that we characterized that exhibited single photon emission. There was a lot more that didn't exhibit single photon emission for two different implantation depths of nitrogen. For bare posts, we see that our lifetime goes from about 60 nanoseconds in bulk all the way to even like 50 nanoseconds in the post. So factor of 3 reduction in rate. And for now, when we put silver on them, the lifetime goes down as it becomes as short as 2 nanoseconds. And at this point, we started being limited also by our apparatus, but our APDs that we have. So this is factor of roughly 5 enhancement and emission compared to bulk. We predict 35. So we're working on that now. And it's also, but it's factor of like 15 to 20 between these two points. Okay, so it's quite remarkable range of emission rates you can do in this way. So this is what I said. Basically, bare nanoposts prolong lifetime, and nanoposts in metal reduce the lifetime. And I think we believe there's applications for both. This is for David. Maybe we did confirm optical electromagnetic resonance. So this silver doesn't really affect much the ODMR spectrum. Of course, we need to look at spin coherence. Yes, this was an excellent question, and I deleted that slide in the interest of time, but I'll tell you, let's go back. Okay, so the reason why we put a lot of silver on top is so that this surface that is exposed to air is as far away from our device as possible, so as silver starts oxidizing, we are not affected right away, right? It turns out more ideal geometry is if the silver is just as tall as the pillar, because then you can start collecting light from top. And I was just about to show you some shortcomings of this approach, which is, I promised you, like millions of counts, but we don't get any more than a nanowire. And the reason is, sure, we enhance emission, but we actually don't collect as efficiently anymore. But if I could planarize this thing, and we are doing this right now, it's a little challenging, we can get best of both worlds. A lot of enhancement in emission and a lot of enhancement in collection efficiency. So really what we need to do also is look at spin coherence, which we didn't do, but it's on the way. So shortcomings of this approach are exactly what I just said. And let's just ignore this. Let's just take a look at this number here. Only 4% of these enhanced emitted photons actually we can collect. And the problem is, again, this interface between diamond and air. Remember, we are looking from the bottom due to this thick silver layer. We cannot look from the top. So still, total internal reflection traps the light in diamond. Even worse, and this is, by the way, this 4 to 5% is into collection lens that we have in the lab, which is numerical aperture 0.95. And air lens also, you can put some, you can put the oil immersion, but we try to stay away from this and really make devices that give you that feature, not using any sort of immersion lenses. Another problem is also coupling to surface plasmon and metal diamond interface. Those actually convert eventually to heat, and you never see them in collection. So that we could fix by adding some gratings. And this was proposed in this paper published by postdoc Irfan Bulu, who is incidentally applying for a job here. Basically, he figured out that if you make grating, it's like bullseye pattern on this interface. It looks something like this. We can basically scatter these plasmons up towards our collection optics. Okay. So this is ongoing work. I'm showing you a lot of stuff that's still not published and it's actually probably a few months away from being even completed, but it's okay. So here is diamond pillar with some grating around, and next thing is to slap, actually we put silver on it. We are characterizing these things. There's always you know, you need to work a little bit on it to get it right. But if this works, then we would be getting this collimated beam of single photons in a way, because this metallic grating, you can think of it as essentially diffractive optical lens. So ideally, I would completely forget about whole optical bench, just slap my fiber right on top of it, glue it, and I would get all these photons inside my fiber with 25% collection efficiency and enhancement factor of 20 or 30, ideally, and this would be very good. So that's where we are getting with this idea. So far, just sort of to summarize where we are at the moment, I told you about how we can collect light using bulk diamond substrates, how we can collect light efficiently, and how we can enhance emission of NV centers efficiently, okay? And we're working combining these two in one geometry that gives you best of both worlds, okay? But still, all of these guys emit light vertically, out of plane, which is good for a lot of stuff, but let's say if I want to build quantum networks on chip, that's not so good. I'd like to integrate a lot of devices, just like I have in some other, like G5s, you know, integrated photonics. You can have a lot of devices on the same chip. And for us, this, we like this to be diamond. Here's why we want it. We'd like to make Jeff Kimball and many at IQC, I suppose, and many others happy by making quantum networks, quantum internet, quantum computers one day integrated. Where the idea is sort of you have some sort of color set. You have some, actually, I forgot where I took this figure from. If it's for somebody in the audience, I apologize. Otherwise, I apologize to the whole world via internet, I guess, because it's being recorded. you have some quantum memory, some, let's say NV in our case, that you can store information into, and then you can get these two nodes of quantum, and you put in a cavity, and you can wire up these cavities via some photonic channel where you exchange flying qubits, photons, and you can do a lot of information processing in quantum domain like that. And that looks much like what people do actually in the non-quantum world. I must use the word normal. Non-quantum world, okay, where nowadays Bergman's group, IBM's folks, Intel folks, Michael Ipsen at Cornell, many, many others are looking into this silicon photonics platform, which looks to integrate optical devices on top of memory, on top of multi-core processor, all realized in silicon for the purpose of efficient communication information exchange between, let's say, different cores, okay? So instead of sending your information via electrons over copper wire, which is very lossy and heats up, people want to do it via photons, right? And so that's actually, silicon is quite nice for that. We think that maybe diamond could be quite nice for quantum ends of things because it has these nice, unique color centers with nice spin and optical properties. How do you do this, right? It's nice, you buy like 6, 8, whatever your favorite size of silicon wafer, and you do standard fabrication bank. Here, you know, you get this 2 by 2 millimeters. That's actually bulk crystal, not even thin film. So how do we do these things? So there's something that we actually spend a bit of time thinking. But before I tell you how, let me just tell you why we want to make cavity. And here are some benefits of putting color center inside the optical resonators. First of all, you can have near 100% collection efficiency and very good coupling efficiency, collection efficiency. Basically because this cavity, which is ring resonator in our case, can be nicely coupled to optical waveguide, at least in other material systems, and then can be nicely outcoupled in fiber. So you can collect all the photons, which is quite nice. The problem of NV is, as I mentioned, that not all emission goes into zero photon line for quantum computation and some other protocols. It's important to get as much emission into zero photon line versus photon sideband. Well, cavity can give you this. If I park my cavity resonance on top of zero photon line via Purcell effect, I can enhance some percentage of photons that go into zero photon line versus photon sideband. So that's another reason. And if I really work hard, I can get into strong coupling regime. It has many interesting applications. And strong coupling regime is basically with interaction rate between color center and photon field inside the cavity overcomes that of photon loss rate and kind of dipole decay rate. And that would allow you to do some fancy stuff in quantum world, that are listed here, basically. Okay, so we are kind of looking into particularly single photon transistors at the moment. We are looking into also entanglement with Michel Lukin and realization of these quantum networks. Down the road, you can take advantage of nonlinearity of diamond, which is Chi3 material, to convert emission in red to telecom, and then you can send it over long distances with optical fibers. That's also very attractive. and we had some ideas, theoretical studies of that, but we are not actually pursuing it experimentally, but it's kind of along the line of what we would like to do. But how do you do it? Well, the main problem is that for everything photonics, and that's, by the way, why we didn't show you anything like this so far. Everything was done in bulk crystal. But for anything photonics, you need to confine light into some thin layer. And any integrated photonics takes advantage of total internal reflection twice to trap the light to these thin waveguide slabs, essentially. So you need to have material with refractiveness N2 on top of material with refractiveness N3, which is smaller than N2, and capped with also material with smaller refractive index. And then you can have waveguide. Well, the problem with that is that actually you cannot grow diamond on anything else other than diamond and get high quality film, with few exceptions mentioned here, recently published. So how do we do this? How do we make this high index contrast, which is needed for photonics? Well, our approach was sort of brute force approach, which is based on thinning. So we take 20, 30 micron thick piece of diamond, we thin it down using our oxygen plasma, you get 200 nanometers thick diamond, and then you do electron beam lithography, make ring resonators, and that's how you do it. Group at HP did this simultaneously, had exactly the same idea. They published also very nice diamond ring resonators using similar approach. So I'll tell you a bit about our work in the next few slides in this space. You can also find more about in the SCLIO talk and a paper posted on archive recently. So so this is it. And Pavle likes it, I see he is. So this is the diamond network. So this is diamond ring resonator. Here's diamond waveguide. Here's couplers. And these couplers are made of polymers. And this is just to bring the light from the optical fiber efficiently into the polymer due to the mode size mismatch. And then from polymer into the diamond waveguide and then out. So this all works nicely. Since we had tons of telecom lasers in our lab, we tested this first in telecom range, so it's non-NV range, but it was easier. Plus, since then, we developed some interest in actually looking into non-quantum applications of diamond photonics, which are plenty. So this actually, we are pursuing this direction as well. So each of these dips are resonances of ring resonators, and you can see we can make very nice resonators with quality factors on the order of 30,000 already in this system. Okay, so it works nicely. But going back to our quantum end of things, so we then scale this down, make smaller resonator that now operates in red. Here's your diamond ring, okay? Here's diamond waveguide with some holes, and these holes in the end are second order gratings that is used to in-couple light and out-couple light. And here's transmission measurement that was done by shooting white light on one end and collecting spectrum on the other end. And you see these dips, and they correspond to resonances of this ring resonator. They go nearly to zero, which is also indicative that at least in some of these cases, we have nearly critical coupled system, which is nice for efficient collection of photons. Qs here are not that high, and this is actually actively being studied. Fabrication could be a problem, but it's not that bad, actually. It could be that there are some of the impurities. This was done also in 1B diamond, which is dirty diamond, with a lot of impurities. It's possible that this actually, there's some absorption due to these impurities that people haven't studied, so we're looking into that. So that was nice, and then, okay, we did, let's see if there is NV, right? If they see if they are lucky, and can we generate single photon inside a ring resonator and route it on chip and then send it out into fiber? And so this is what we did. This was done in collaboration also with Misha Lukin, and this published in this paper by Birgit, who I mentioned was intern in my group, and since then she was so spectacular. She's now a second year grad student. And basically what they did, they used these two collection arm confocal microscope where you have excitation in green. You shoot light at this sample. Here's NV center. Red light gets emitted, but now you split it with beam splitter and you can go directly to the fiber with these static mirrors, or you can send it on a galvo and basically scan galvo, which really allows you to collect from different points that you excite, right? So this scheme allows us to collect light from the same excitation point as well as from any point on a chip, right? So this is nice now because what I can do, once I look with this first channel, I see color center, I park my green laser here, and I scan with this mirror and obtain the image, and I get exactly what you would expect to get. You get a lot of photons where NV is, okay? And you get a lot of photons where the grating is, two gratings in the waveguide, and you don't get any photons anywhere else, which means the waveguides are pretty good. Low loss, cavity is pretty good, you don't see it, so it's good. Now, you want to make sure this is NV. So first, let's forget about NV, let's make sure it's single photon. So you do anti-bunching. In this case, we did cross-correlation between, well, it's actually self-correlation between the same point, but two different collection channels, and you see a nice dip that goes well below 0.5, but also you can cross-correlate this point and that point, right? So now, if photon is here, it shouldn't be there, and if it's here, it shouldn't be there, and it's exactly what you see, that this dip goes to 0.2, okay? So it's indeed single photon generation inside a ring resonator, and it gets routed around, okay? You check the spectrum to make sure it's not some junk. It's actually, though I don't know a lot of single photon emitting junk, but you know, maybe you get lucky every once in a while. So you, indeed, it is single NV emission profile, and it is NV emission. And then also in when you collect light from the grating, also you see this nice resonances of the ring resonator, which is quite nice. So that made us very happy. But then also, we wanted to cool it. We wanted to tune the resonance of the ring resonator to the zero photon line, and we wanted to get in strong coupling. Then you do a little bit of calculation just to design this properly, and then you find out to do that, you actually need better cavity. Okay, this cavity is too big. Q is decent, though Qs of hundreds of thousands are needed, and mode volume, the size of the cavity needs to be bigger. So then you start looking into your favorite paper. This is a nice review article from Kerry Vahala. That summarizes different cavity geometries that one can use for different applications, including strong light-matter interaction. And you find out these photonic crystal cavities are pretty good. These numbers are outdated. And incidentally, I spent all of my PhD career working on photonic crystals, and we do a lot of photonic crystals in my group now. So, of course, we knew about this and we wanted to do that first, but actually ring resonators were a little simpler. But anyhow, it turns out that actually using this photonic crystal geometry, you can indeed get to Qs of hundreds of thousands of small mode volumes. But actually, we figure out we can do even better. Right? We can make even a smaller cavity, more integrated, and more importantly, particularly tailored to problems in fabrication of these thin films that I didn't mention, but I'll be happy to answer questions if you ask me later. So we wanted to look into these 1D cavities, right, that you can find on the cover of this very nice book on photonic crystals that I recommend reading. These are so-called, we call them photonic crystal nanobeam cavities, but these are actually some of the first photonic crystal cavities ever made and published in Nature like 14 years ago by a nice set of people at MIT. So what it is basically you have waveguides. So now I'm departing from diamond, just tell you a little bit about cavity, we'll come back to diamond in a few slides. So what it is essentially a piece of silicon in this case again, and this is your favorite materials platform to test stuff because it's very well understood. And there's a lot of lasers that operate at a suitable wavelength range. And what you do, you make your Bragg mirror. This is a ray of these coils. Bragg mirror on the other side. You leave a little bit of space in between to form a cavity. You put it together, and you get a cavity indeed, but the Q of this cavity is only 300. I told you I need 100,000. It's not quite good. But it turns out there is actually ways to improve this. And the main loss mechanism in this geometry is the fact that light gets scattered significantly at this interface between the waveguide and the Bragg mirror due to impedance mismatch, okay? So the way to improve this is to taper, make some of these holes smaller to nicely actually taper this profile from the waveguide into the mirror profile and you have very nice reflection efficiency then. So if you do this and you put two and two together, turns out you can totally lose even this little waveguide section between, you get something like this. We spend a lot of time working on, and here's design of nice ultra high Q cavity with Q of 10 to the 7, very small mode volume, realized design for silicon applications, though in this paper we show how you can do this in silicon nitride, and we have papers on diamond as well. So you can, you know, it's material agnostic, this approach. Some of the best results we've done so far in this cavity geometry is made in silicon, so just one slide here. And this is your silicon waveguide patterned with holes, and it has many interesting advantages and applications. I'm gonna not go into details because I'm running out of time. Bottom line is these are also optical but also mechanical resonators. So you can start coupling optics and mechanics, which is also what we do, but I'm not gonna talk about this today. And just to confirm that indeed, this geometry gives you very high quality factors. We measure this in telecom, we get Qs about or a million experimentally, which is quite nice. All right, so for those, you can integrate them on the same chip, and you can have a lot of fun with them. But let me just go through these slides, and I'm going to skip these two in interest of time. I want to tell you now how we can also make them in diamond. Okay, so this is it. So using the same technology of thin diamond films, we basically realized these nanobeam cavities inside 200 or so nanometer thick diamond layer on top of silicon dioxide. And pattern these lattice of holes. This is Bragg mirrors. Here's your cavity geometry. And you can also release them so they can be freestanding, just like a silicon ones. It can be important to certain applications. I promise that indeed you can design things in diamond as well. This is for one of the papers that we published. This was now designed for diamond, 5 millions. Nice mode volume, so we should be well into strong coupling if we can do this experimentally. And here's experimental results. This is ongoing work, not published. I guess now it is online, but it's quite promising. So basically, here's confocal image. Here's, we get lucky. We have one NV inside the cavity, all right? Here's now confocal mode profile of this thing. You see this is now cavity boundaries. So holes run in this direction, this direction. This is the center of the cavity. You see that light emission is actually confined to the center, as it should be, small mode volume. You check anti-bunching, nice dip, so it's single photon source. And now you want to see if you have some enhancement. This was done not at low temperature, as it should, but at room temperature. So we will see in the spectrum this very nice sharp peak that is enhanced emission of phonon sideband with Purcell factor in the order of 10. Okay, so it's quite nice, not quite in strong coupling yet. For strong coupling, we'd like to tune this resonance back to zero phonon line around 637 nanometers, somewhere around here, okay? And we'd like to make a little better cavity with Qs on the order of, as I said, 100,000, and then we can be in strong coupling limit. That should be quite exciting. And so this is ongoing work with Michel Lukin's group as well, and hopefully in the very near future, we'll have some of these results to share with you. Okay, so I think I'm ready to start summarizing. So basically, we showed you what we've been working on lately is this nanofabrication technique for single crystal diamond, and showed you a bunch of devices, including nice diamond rings, which I find more exciting than these diamond rings. But you know, that's a matter of preference, I guess. Then, using these fabrication techniques, we made some diamond nanowires that are good for increase of collection efficiency of photons. To increase production rate, you take advantage of some cavities based on metallic structures, this diamond plus onyx. And when you put everything together, you can start dreaming about this integrated diamond-based on-chip platform for quantum networks based on photonic crystal nano-cavities and waveguides. And basically, we are, as I said, pursuing strong coupling, sensitive magnetometry, and even optomechanics with these structures, which is quite exciting. So this is the gang that did most of the work. Really, these three people did all of the experiments. Tom was leading nanowire effort and built all, essentially, most of the experimental characterization infrastructure. Birgit was involved with fabrication of all devices and particular cavities. And Jen was leading plasmonic effort. And these three gentlemen provided a lot of theory behind, and Irfan also worked, his postdoc, he actually worked with Jen and built the setup that they used then to measure plasmonics. These are guys, part of the bigger group, people in my group that does stuff. And here are our three Waterloo guys. It's Mike Burek, maybe some of you know him. Mike is fantastic. So is Ian Burgess. So Mike was nanotech, applied math, I think. And we also have Haig, who is EE guy. Work with him at Hamid Majedi here. So we have three Waterloo students. So I'm very impressed by these three guys as well as these other folks. None of this would be possible without generous funding and fantastic group of people at Harvard primarily that we work with, mostly physicists that we collaborate with. And of course, material comes from Element 6, Dan Twitcher and Matt Markham, who are providing beautiful materials to us. And I'd like to finally thank you for your attention, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.